us today for this liturgy. Thank you for all of you who are tuning in to WENT AM 1340 Radio here in Fulton County. Thank you to all of you who are joining us on Facebook. Thank you to all of you who are joining us on YouTube. We are glad to welcome you to this liturgy as we celebrate together the third Sunday of Easter. And so at this time, we gather our thoughts, confident in the love of God, His care, and His forgiveness. Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another and to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of sin and division. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you intercede for us with your Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen. And together let us proclaim the glory of God, Mother Gloria.
To you and listen to my word. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus Nazarene was a man commended to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God works through him in your midst, as you yourself know. This man delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the thrones of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, I saw the Lord ever before me. With him at my side, my right hand, I shall not be disturbed. Therefore, my heart has been glad, and my tongue has exulted. My flesh, too, with dwelt in hope, because you will not abandon with my soul to the netherworld, nor will suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. My brothers, you can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of Christ, that neither he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus. Of this we all are witnesses. Exalted at the right hand of God, he received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth, as you see and hear, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Conduct yourselves with reverence during the time of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as a spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has surely been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how it was made known to them in the breaking of bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Without failure, without struggle, there can be no faith. Interesting words, aren't they? Interesting words. Unfortunately, I can't say that I came up with that sentence on my own, or sentences. I can't say that I came up with that saying by myself. Rather, they were words shared unto me by a priest to whom I went to confession to recently. And those words were shared with him with another veteran priest. Without struggles, there cannot be faith. Without failure, there cannot be faith. And when we take a look at those sayings right there, when we take a look at what that means, it helps us to see that, yes, God is with us during our moments of success. God is with us when we feel good about ourselves. God is there when we say, "Lord, I have worked really hard to be able to accomplish this goal. I tried my best, and I did well. I got that good grade on that test, or I got that promotion at work, or perhaps something like I finally was able to master that handed down family recipe that I received many years ago." However, we also see that God is with us during our moments of struggles. God is there during our failures. He is there also when we are disappointed in ourselves. And we are reminded that without struggles, without failure, there can be no faith. And we might ask ourselves at first, well, what exactly does that mean? Does God want us to fail? No, that isn't the case. Rather, the idea is that when we stumble along the way, when we have those little moments of failure, it allows us to take a step back, to realize we ourselves are dependent upon God. We ourselves are not God, but rather it is through the grace of God active within us so that when we do have success, it is not necessarily just because of what we did, but rather we are participating with the grace that God gives us. And likewise, I think when we have those stumbling moments, when we have those moments of failure, it is good to realize that God is with us, and that God often works through those moments where maybe we're not necessarily happy with ourselves, maybe we're not necessarily all that thrilled with results that we're looking for, whether they are professional results or personal results. But God works through those moments. It is good to remember that for a lot of reasons. It is good to remember that because there can be times when we might be excessively harsh with ourselves. We think, gee, can I do anything right? Can I possibly do anything right? I feel like I have the opposite of the Midas touch. The Midas touch, you know, is that everything turns to gold. Whereas in some cases, we feel like everything I try to do, it backfires on me. We can all have those moments. We certainly can. There can be moments where we feel the sting of failure, and we have to be able to contend with that. But we also know, too, that God works in those moments. Now, from a pop culture standpoint, I'm reminded of a pivotal scene in Star Wars: The Last Jedi. There is a part of the movie there where Luke Skywalker, he's very disgusted with what is happening. He is sad at himself, kicking himself, thinking that he has failed one of his former students, Kylo Ren, who was the former Ben Solo. And he is now exiled himself to this island to stay there and to spend the rest of his days in isolation. And then, lo and behold, his old master, Yoda, appears to him, and he reminds him that failure is a very good teacher, because failure helps us to be able to see where we need to improve. And failure keeps us humble, and it also allows us to be able to continue on, trusting that we shouldn't give up, even if we've had to stumble along the way, even if it takes us a while to find the right path. Now, getting back to a spiritual standpoint, we can also see how failure, when we have those moments of failure, we can go in one of a couple of different directions. Take the example of St. Peter. St. Peter is someone who knew what it was like to stumble quite a bit. Jesus didn't choose St. Peter to be our first pope because Peter always had his act together, not always. But rather, Jesus saw that Peter could do great things and learn from his failures. Consider what Peter did. I mean, no sooner has he declared that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, he misunderstands what Jesus' role as a suffering Messiah, and he says, heaven forbid should he die. And so Jesus tells him to get away, Satan. You're thinking not as God thinks, but as human beings think. Or consider the episode on the Sea of Galilee, where Jesus is walking on the water, and Peter asks if he can follow after Jesus. For a moment, it seems to be going pretty well, but then the wind begins to blow, and Peter struggles, and he has doubts, and he begins to fall beneath the waves, and he begins to drown, and he reaches out for Jesus to help him. There can be times when we feel like those waves of life are surrounding us, those winds are surrounding us, and we can feel like Peter also, kind of ashamed of ourselves afterwards, thinking, you know, why did we doubt? But again, those moments of failure, they can be great teachers, they can motivate us. However, on the flip side, we also know, too, the enemy can use our failures and twist them around. Rather than allowing them to be teaching moments, rather than allowing to be more opportunities to say, okay, Lord, I trust that I myself am not God, I trust that you are God. It may take me a while to succeed, but with your help, I can. The enemy chooses the opposite. The enemy chooses to pin us into an imaginary corner and whispers deviously into our ears, you are a failure. This is how you are defined. And the enemy tries to twist those life lessons into a paralyzing sense of fear that leaves us feeling wounded and leaves us feeling as if there is no way out. And it's this feeling as if we are trapped and we have no way to help ourselves. Thankfully, we know that isn't the case. That Jesus uses our moments of failure to help us, and he uses them to teach us and to learn to depend upon him. Going back to the example of Peter, all we have to do is take a look at our first reading today, taken from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, or take a look at our second reading for today, taken from the first letter of Peter, chapter 1. In both cases, we have Peter who, even though he stumbled, even though he fell, and he had to get up time and time again, even though he denied Jesus in the courtyard there, he denied him, I did not know this man, Peter was able to learn from his moments of weakness, to trust that the Lord would be with him, and to boldly proclaim that, yes, Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. The same Jesus whom the authorities have put to death is now risen, and this is the fulfillment as found in the book of Psalms. And he refers to that when he says how King David had foretold of Jesus. The Psalms are, in a spiritual way, attributed to King David, to the wisdom of David, and Jesus is the fulfillment. And so, likewise, when we find ourselves confronting our own failures, our own struggles, there are a couple different ways we can look at them. We have to be cautious to not go down the path that the devil wants us to go down. The devil wants us to feel trapped. He wants us to feel guilt, if we are somehow marked or that we are identified by our failures. Jesus sees our failures, he sees our struggles as opportunities for his grace. He sees them as opportunities to reach out to us. All we have to do is say, yes, Lord, I accept your offer of grace. I want to participate with them, and I want to succeed with your help. And so we give thanks for these opportunities to succeed with the help of Jesus. And so if we find ourselves struggling, if we find ourselves looking at our failures, again, we realize that St. Peter knew what it was like to struggle. He knew what it was like to taste the bitterness of failure. But thankfully, he also knew too what it meant to be able to get up, to symbolically dust himself off, and to trust that the Lord would be with him, and that the Lord would help him to learn from his past struggles, and that he could succeed with the grace of God. God bless you.
Let's profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds in the Father and the Son, who were the Father and the Son, his adored and glorified,
who has spoken to the prophets.
I believe in one holy Catholic Apostolic Church.
I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now that we've been nourished by the Word of God, let us now turn our attention to the needs of the world.
For the Church throughout the world, may Jesus, our head, grant us reconciliation and unity. Let us pray to the Lord. Nations, may there be peace in every place experiencing violence and war. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us, hear our prayer.
For those saddened by loss or discouragement, may the promise of the rising Lord lift from their despair. Let us pray to the Lord. Those of the community who struggles with their faith, may God, who open their hearts and nourish them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us, hear our prayer.
For all our brothers and sisters in Christ who have died, and they rejoice in the presence of our Heavenly Father, let us pray to the Lord.
Special way for all those who are affected by COVID-19, both those who are sick as well as those who are taking care of the sick. And we also pray for all those who are struggling due to isolation, due to feeling lonely and helpless, that the Lord may provide them with the assistance that they need. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. these prayers to Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
Please join us in singing our offertory song, number 282, in the Heritage Missal, Ward of the Dance.
Joy, every land, every people exult. sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, graciously grant peace in our days, that
by the help of your mercy, may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who has said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And
with your spirit. Let's offer each other the sign of peace. Peace with you. us who are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries, may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And again, thank you to all of you who are joining us today for this liturgy, either through the radio, through Facebook, or through YouTube. And also, too, I want to thank all the ministers, the lectors, music ministry, that have assisted us over the last month or so with these recorded liturgies. Very grateful for your continued help in bringing the Word of God home, so that way those of us who cannot be here in church physically are still connected spiritually. So thank you for sharing your gifts with us. Thank you also, too, for the camera operators who have made this possible, too. And so I'm very grateful for your assistance. Please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son, was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing. Amen. May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to your eternal inheritance. Amen. And may you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever. Amen. Go in peace. Thanks be to God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him and humbly pray. And to thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, for the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. So this is a joke from a book called The Laugh-A-Day Book of Bloopers, Quotes, and Good Clean Jokes. Two women came before wise King Solomon, dragging between them a young man in a three-piece suit. This young lawyer agreed to marry my daughter, one said. No, he agreed to marry my daughter, the other said. They haggled before the king until he called for silence. Bring me my biggest sword, Solomon said, and I shall hew the young attorney in half. Each of you shall receive a half. Sounds good to me, the first lady said. But the second woman said, oh, sire, do not spill innocent blood. Let the other woman's daughter marry him. The wise king did not hesitate a moment. The attorney must marry the first lady's daughter, he proclaimed. But she was willing to hew him in two, the king's court exclaimed. Indeed, wise King Solomon said, that shows she is the true mother-in-law.